black thing go from left to right, and I thought, I'm gonna die out here, no one's ever gonna know.
I couldn't believe what my eyeballs were showing me. I'll never forget how evil the eyes were. It was horrible. I mean, I've never seen nothing that evil.
It ran towards me at a rate that I can't even explain. Turned and stared at me, and this look of, I just want to kill you. I want to say it was human, but it wasn't.
He was yelling at me to grab a gun. I was like, for what? He said, just grab a gun. And there's footprints all the way to the door of my house. It had went inside my garage all the way to the door.
911, what are you reporting?
Jesus Christ, you better...
Sir?
Zia!
Hello?
Get somebody out here.
What's going on now, sir?
That son of a bitch is about 6'9", I don't know.
Do you see him now, sir?
Yes, I'm looking right at him.
Uh-oh.
You're listening to Sasquatch Chronicles. Check us out online at sasquatchchronicles.com. If you've had an encounter, email me. My email address is wes@sasquatchchronicles.com. I'm trying to figure out the board, and this big guy spins me around, and he's obviously drunk at this point. Yeah. He's like, tell me about, I need to know about them moving unnatural. And I go, what? You said they move unnatural. Explain yourself. And I was like, what are you talking about? I was like, I'm kind of in the middle of something right now. I'm not trying to be a dick, but can we talk later? I was like, I'm really kind of in the middle of something. Well, all right. Turns his back, starts walking off. So I go back to working on the board. And I feel someone like lean over behind me. And he's like, I need to know. Comes up real close to my ear. I need to know. What did you mean when you said unnatural? And I lean around. I was like, are you kidding me? Is this guy for real? Is your name really Bingo?
No, my real name is Trinidad.
Well, I'm going to call you Bingo.
My nickname is Bingo. Everybody knows me as Bingo.
You were a pain in the ass that night. So go ahead and apologize to me and it'll all be over with. Go ahead. I'm waiting for my apology.
Maybe I read a book when I was
Is your mother a little ashamed that you show up and you're hammered and you harass podcasters at live events?
My mama is proud of me. My mama is so proud of me. She says, and I got a full scholarship because of the way I played football, the heart that I played with. And my mom is so proud of me because every game I come, she didn't have to pay for my coat.
Yeah, you bench like 900 pounds, Bingo. There's not many too many guys out there that can bench 900 pounds, you know what I mean? And that was Bingo, everyone. Greatest caller ever. I enjoyed interviewing him on Friday night's show. I know a lot of the members didn't care for him, but, you know, and our friendship got off to a little rocky start. But, you know, we really like each other now. And I thought Bingo was hilarious. I thought he was very entertaining. And I know the members are like, keep him on the public shows, not on the member-only shows. So I'm going to unleash him on the public. I can't wait. So excited. Here's a fun fact. In 1976, a Soviet pilot defected to Japan in his advanced MiG-25 fighter, which Russia demanded be returned. Japan complied, but only after allowing American engineers to examine the aircraft. Japan then shipped it back piece by piece and billed Russia $40,000 in transport and labor costs. I guess God bless America. You guys never said you wanted it back in one piece. I kind of blame Russia for this story. You said we, didn't have to come back in one piece. You guys never said we couldn't take a little peek under the hood. Memorial Day will be observed on Monday, May 27th, and it commemorates the men and women who died while in military service. I want to thank everyone out there who serves this country, a lot of heroes, men and women. Thank you so much for your service, and thank you so much for listening to the show. Well, let's get into the show tonight. I burned up a lot of time with that with that intro. That bingo guy, man, he's hilarious. You know, I don't think I ever actually got an apology from that guy, which is even more hilarious. Tonight, we'll be talking to three different guests. A couple people have them on their property, and one gentleman actually shot one of these creatures in the back when he was hunting. Very fascinating story. If you've had an encounter and you'd like to be on the show, shoot me an email. My email address is wes@sasquatchchronicles.com. Let's jump into it tonight. I want to welcome Kyle to the show. Kyle, thanks for coming on.
Pleasure having me. I mean, you.
Not bad. No. It's good, man. I'm really appreciate the fact that you came on. And I know there's a lot of things that happened in West Virginia. If you would, before we get to the sighting, what kind of things were happening around that property prior to you actually seeing it?
Just odd noises. I had this big bay window in the basement. I know it's odd to have a bay window in a basement, but this was like an apartment upstairs and downstairs that someone just said, screw it, and turned it into an actual house. I'd be down there at night, working on the floor and painting, and just odd something walking past the window. Or you just feel real not safe even in a house.
Yeah, just a lot of strange things that were going on. Did you ever pinpoint to what it was or why you had such an uneasy feeling prior to the sighting, I mean?
Woods are creepy sometimes, that's all I ever thought about. I was like, maybe it's just, there's a deer out there watching me. I mean, raccoon. I'm terrified of raccoon, so.
Yeah, you and me both. Well, tell me about the night of your sighting. What were you doing, and walk us into what happened? What did you see?
It was in June 2009. I do not rightly remember the day. It was about 10 o'clock at night. I had just opened the door to step outside, and my cat took off outside, big old fat tabby. But he was an outside cat. He was, used to just being outside. So I walk down the steps and start walking down to the car because we were trying to get to Blockbuster. Yes, this is when Blockbuster existed. Go turn in movies, pick up some new movies. We didn't have exactly cable out there, so it was the only way to really entertain ourselves. I start walking down the porch, and my cat shoots back in the house. That's odd for him. He's big. He's even taken on the neighbor dog a couple of times. So that's a little odd. And I just keep walking, and then I stop because I feel very uncomfortable. Something was watching me. So, sorry, man. Talking about this always freaks me out.
That's all right, man. You're doing fine.
So, when something's staring at you, normally your eyes scan and find it. I looked up on to the hill, and there was this large oak tree, like right on the edge of my yard. Like, where the grass grows up against it, where we don't cut. And this thing was standing there, leaning against the tree, staring at me. He had one arm wrapped around the tree. And he kind of rocked, back and forth, like leaning outwards and then back to the tree itself. I didn't exactly feel threatened, but I was too scared to move. And we just stared at each other.
Yeah, that's unnerving. It's very unnerving, yeah.
Oh.
Can you describe for the audience what you saw?
Where the grass grew up, I could only see about, I'd say, his kneecaps and up. He had real long black hair. It's kind of matted in places, like maybe like around his chest and his shoulders. And I could see, you know, like that charcoal, like gray skin of his face. He didn't make any mouth, you know, movements towards me or anything like that. He just continued to stare at me. He had like a short nose, like kind of pushed in. You know, they say like they have like, they look like they have Down syndrome and whatnot.
Yeah, some people say that, yeah.
It looked more man than ape.
And how far away from you is it, Kyle, when you're looking at this thing? I mean, what kind of a distance are we talking about?
Say about 40, maybe 50 feet.
Oh, wow, really close. It's not like he's a football field away or anything. He's right there.
No, he was right on the edge of my yard.
And when you say more human-like as opposed to ape-like, are you talking about the facial expressions or just the way he stood like a man? How do you define that?
I say it was his facial, his face. Like, he had high cheekbones. I couldn't really see his ears. Body-wise, he did not look like a man. I mean, his arms were just way too long. The way he was able to, like, wrap around that tree, but, like, still have some arm length, you know. Because that wasn't a small tree. That was a big tree.
How big do you think he was? I realize you're guessing at 50 feet, you know, something to that extent. But in your best estimation, how big would you say he was?
Well, from where he was standing, I thought that he was standing on, like, a knoll. I thought he was. I went back out there, like, the next morning and took a tape measure to the tree. But my guess when I first saw him was maybe about a little over 7 foot.
And what did
when
you...
I took or go the ahead. Tape measure, he was about 8'9".
Oh, after the tape measure?
Yeah, because the way the grass grows up right there, there's hillside and then there's a dip. He was standing in the dip.
So you guys are looking at each other. What happens next?
My wife at the time didn't hear me start the car. So she yelled out the door, you know, hey, what are you doing? So I was able to break my gaze from him and look back at the house. And she didn't come outside. But when I looked back, he was now looking at the doorway and not at me. You know? And then I looked back again to make sure she was coming, you know, like, you know, are you seeing this thing? And by the time I looked back a second time, he was already walking up the hill. Back turned to me and everything.
And did it appear to be like man-like as it was going up the hill, or would you say it was more ape-like? I know you're getting a view now from behind.
He walked like a man. Like, hunched, but in low. Like, I couldn't take the steps he took. I mean, my knees are already bad, but I couldn't. Just the way he moves, kind of like to the ground, but not. If that makes any sense.
Yeah, kind of hunched over. Yeah, I completely get what you're saying. What did you think you were looking at the time? I mean, what was going through your mind when you saw this thing?
I need to get out of here now.
Yeah.
I always believed that Bigfoot was a possibility. You know, but that's the Pacific Northwest, you know, that's where they're from. That's where all the sightings happen. I honestly didn't know what I was looking at. You know, like, it's not a gorilla. It wasn't a man.
Yeah, and I think a lot of people have that opinion, Kyle, especially down there in, like, you get to Kentucky, West Virginia, those areas, and... I don't think it's talked about as much. I almost think there's more that goes on there than in the Pacific Northwest. I just think there's a weird culture here in the Pacific Northwest where people talk about it. You'll drive around and see Sasquatch bars. You'll see Bigfoot bars. You'll see museums. And everyone's pretty open about it here. You know, either someone has seen one or they know someone who's seen one. And you get that same thing down where you're at, down in the West Virginia, Kentucky area, except for the fact that people down there don't talk about it. They don't openly discuss it. And I'm not really sure why that is, if it's a cultural thing or not, but I've probably talked to more people off the air from Kentucky, West Virginia area than you've ever heard on the air because they don't want to come on.
You face a lot of ridicule around here.
That's what I heard. Yeah, that's what I heard, that there definitely is. Well, before we get into your theories and everything like that, you had mentioned you had two other encounters. Now, did those other encounters happen on the property?
Yes and no. The other happened a little closer to where I live now. Like I said when we talked, I started to notice things that I didn't notice before. You know, in the middle of the night, something slapped the house. Rocks. Where our kitchen sat up at, you could look down onto the roof of the back porch. And there's just these big, like, fist-sized rocks up on top of that roof. No idea where they came from. You know, it's not like I live up on a mountainside or anything like that where rocks could fall off the hill into a house. There's just nothing but trees above me.
Yeah, they'd almost have to be thrown up there for them to be on the home.
Right.
So this is relatively close to your property, you said, that you had that first experience?
Yeah, I live about 15 miles north of there from now.
Well, tell me about it. What happened?
One night, we were all sitting out on the porch. This is that same place. We were grilling, and it's real dark. Real dark. And that thicket of trees, like where I saw that first one, you know, that's all pretty well overgrown. It's late into the summer now. Kept hearing these noises, like grunts and growls. And you've seen the silhouette of these things before, right? Like, it's just dark enough to where you can see there's one there, but you can't actually see it.
Right, yeah.
There were like three of them. And they were going back and forth between these bramble patches, just hooping and hollering and making all kinds of racket. And we were on the porch. We went in the house after that. I don't know what they were doing up there, but I know that there's a game trail that runs through there, and deer come through there a lot. Or maybe they were just curious as what the hell we were doing on the porch.
Yeah, it's interesting. I've heard that before. I've heard that personally myself, and I've heard other witnesses describe that, and I'm like trying to explain to them. I was like, and you might disagree with this, but I was like, take a bunch of monkeys, cross it with what you perceive to be caveman, and that's kind of what I heard. You know, it sounded like they were up there somewhere between animals and people. Sound like they're having a party up there.
You know, honestly, I don't disagree with you. I agree.
Yeah, it's odd when you hear it, and I think it's a hunting thing. I think they go off after they hunt. That's my theory, but I don't know. What did you think was going on? Do you think it was more or less because you guys were on the property and they were reacting to that?
They didn't seem to. I don't feel like at any point in time they were directing at us, because they were about a good 60, 70 feet away. Like, I know that's still pretty close.
Yeah, that's really close, man.
They didn't seem to pay us any mind.
Yeah, it makes you wonder why they were going off. Well, tell me about the second encounter. I guess it would be the third technically, but tell me about the other encounter that you had.
Oh, me and a friend were out on this road. It's called Pierce's Run. And a good-sized creek runs right alongside the road. And there's, like, you know, natural waterfalls and just really deep parts of the creek. Well, we spent a couple of weeks digging out this underneath of this waterfall. And we dug it out pretty good to where we could turn it into our own little personal swimming hole. And this is one of those roads that's really out in the sticks. Nobody goes on it. Few people live on it. Well, you know, after all that hard work and effort, we went out there and we start swimming one day. We were having a good time. And I saw a deer up on the hillside. Not that that really means anything. It was running up the hillside pretty quickly too. And then pebbles kept, like, falling in the water around us. And I started looking around, you know, like, my friend's like, oh, man, maybe it's just a deer. Maybe when he was running up the hill, you know, he kicked some rocks back down at us. And I'm like, yeah, that's a possibility. We just started looking up and up at the trees, like, you know, maybe it's like walnuts or something falling off the trees. You know, there's no nuts on the trees, so nothing was falling down. And it just kept happening. And then that feeling we talked about, I just overcame me. And I looked at my friend and I was like, let's just get out of here. And he's like, why, man? I'm like, let's just go. you know, let's just, we need to leave. We shouldn't be here. So we left. And I mean, I don't know. Could have been that deer. I don't think it's that likely. I mean, I'm not afraid of a deer.
Yeah, especially you know. Pebbles being thrown. I think that throws most people off, especially hunters. I hear it mainly from hunters where they're sitting in an area and all of a sudden they start getting pelted with pebbles and they can't figure out really where it's coming from. It's not, obviously, pebbles don't fall from trees. And unless someone's out there throwing it, what else could it be? You know what I mean?
Right.
It's fascinating. It makes me wonder if they're still kind of around that property. Let me ask you, Kyle, what do you think Sasquatch is? If someone were to ask you, hey, what do you think Sasquatch is? I mean, you got a good look at one. What would you say to them?
I've thought about this a lot over the years. And I've listened to your show a lot over the years. So there's so many ideas that come to mind. I don't think this is, like I said, I don't think it's a biblical thing. But I don't know, you know. So much of this world we don't yet understand. I want to believe that it's flesh and blood. Like, you ever heard that saying that humans only have 10% of their brain unlocked?
Yeah, I think it's actually less than that. But yeah, I've heard that before.
Well, what if these things have more, you know? Like, if they're supposedly so human-like.
Yeah, it's a, go ahead, I'm sorry.
But like, I was just going to say, I just don't rightly know.
Yeah, and there's nothing wrong with that, and it's not a trick question. I think sometimes people think it's a trick question where I'm going to be like, aha, I gotcha. But the beauty of that question is no one really knows, and no one's really wrong. And I've heard everything from aliens to Nephilim to apes to people to... and there's no wrong answer. You know, how can you criticize someone's answer when you don't know? You know, you have no clue one way or another.
I don't think they're furry for his friends.
I would agree with you on that. I would agree with you on that. I think, and you might disagree with me on this, but I think there is a humanity in them in the same way there's humanity in chimpanzees or, you know, apes or, you know, even your dog. Sometimes you can look at, maybe I'm oversimplifying things, but they are, I would say they're more animalistic than human-like. But
there's definitely some intelligence in those eyes.
Exactly. You would have to be an idiot. And when people say, oh, they're human, I kind of get what they're saying. You know, I can't give those people too hard a time. I don't think they're human. But I understand when people say that. And, you could make an argument for some of that stuff. But I honestly think they're more animalistic than they are human. That's my own.
I have a question for you, Wes.
Sure.
Have you ever heard of these things throwing snowballs?
No.
All right. Probably a good thing.
Nope, just why? Why do you ask?
A story a friend told me at work one day.
Of them throwing snowballs?
Of something throwing snowballs from the woods about 4 o'clock in the morning.
Oh,
I was
really?
Like, you probably got kids just messing around your house.
Yeah, and that argument sometimes I wonder about because, you know, like in Kentucky, man, it's a great place to get shot. You start screwing around with someone out there in the middle of the woods. I mean, not just Kentucky. I mean, you could say the same for Washington State.
It's the same for West Virginia.
Yeah. I mean, Texas, any state, really. You go out to some of these properties where people are in the middle of nowhere, and, you know, 911, you might be 2 hours before a cop shows up. So you're going to be facing the end of a barrel in most cases. And so I just had a lady I was talking to. She's like, I thought it was a prowler slapping her house. And I'm like, you live in the middle of freaking nowhere in Kentucky. There's no way. I mean, you'd have to have a lot of balls to walk up and start slapping someone's house in the middle of the night because your chances of getting shot are pretty high.
Right. Like, even that place where I lived at Wheeling, it wasn't terribly residential, but I had neighbors. You know, it was snug up against a golf course, which is just, you know, they always say, well, they're not in residential areas. You ever heard of encroachment?
Yeah, I think that they are. I mean, in most cases, if you look at, you know, I look at a lot of encounters here in Washington State, and to be honest with you, they are in residential areas. In fact, I would say most encounters happen around residential areas as opposed to being, hey, I was 100 miles out in the middle of nowhere and I ran into these things. I would say most encounters actually happen around, you know, not like downtown LA, but, and you're right, I think it's encroachment. I think you're 100% right.
Well, yeah, we didn't have coyotes like about 20 years ago. Coyotes weren't that big of a thing. now, my neighbor's chickens, they're all gone. Coyotes. You know, my neighbor's dog, cat, gone. Coyotes. And you actually see them running up and down the hillside. They're getting pushed out of their natural areas.
Yeah, and I think that's what's happening with these things. I think that they, as we build farther and farther out, you know, you can look at encounters here in Washington State, for example, and there's a town called Battleground. And in the 70s, there was a lot of encounters in Battleground. You won't see that today. It's farther north where people are having encounters because the city's grown so much. There's too many people around. It's not like Battleground's very big anyway, but not far from there, if you go north a little bit, you'll see encounter after encounter after encounter. And I think that we are pushing them. But, you know, with your encounters, you have to keep me up to date. Let me know if anything else happens. I know you're only 15 miles away, but still relatively close, man. You have to let me know if anything else happens, will you?
I definitely will, but I tend to stay away from those areas now.
Yeah, I don't blame you, man. I don't blame you one bit.
When I first stumbled upon it, that was all the rage. It was all I could think about. I couldn't sleep. I just wanted to learn more. I was just listening to your shows. This is a surprise I haven't been eating yet. And I was like, hey, you know what? These aren't furry forest friends. Because, you know, that's what people think most of the time. Like you know what? Like that missing 411 stuff. I don't want to be part of those numbers.
Yeah, you and me both. You and me both. Well, I know you were apprehensive coming on. I appreciate coming on, Kyle. I enjoyed hearing your encounters and your take on things.
Well, I appreciate it, too, and I will keep you up to date.
Thanks, brother. Next up, I want to welcome Kelly to the show. Kelly, thanks for coming on.
Wes, thanks so much for having me. I'm really excited about this.
Yeah, I'm excited to have you on, and I know you definitely have activity going on in your property, and I'll include the picture of the footprint that you sent me in this underneath this episode. And you've had a lot of things happen to you out there in Kentucky. When did all this start? If you would, just kind of walk us into it and walk us into when you actually saw the creature. How did all this begin on the property?
Well, basically, my husband has lived on the property most of his life, except for a hiatus that we took in another part of Kentucky. And there were things that he saw as a teenager, but as far as, like, you know, major activity, it started probably the first part of this year that we started really putting two and two together. Now, I could go back a couple years and say, well, this could have been involved or that could have been involved. But honestly, at that point, it would just be speculation, and I'm too much of a skeptic to, you know, try to tie things to something if I'm not 100% certain of what sure. I was experiencing.
Yeah.
So in February, we started experiencing really, really strong skunk smells, you know, kind of that wet dog, nasty mop water, skunky kind of smell, you know. And at the time we thought, well, we've got coyotes standing nearby or something along that line. And again, the skeptic in me also realizes that it could have been coyotes. But it wasn't a consistent smell. You know, like, you've got a coyote den near the house, it's going to smell that way pretty much all the time, you know. It's not going to be just episodic, I guess. Sorry, I say a lot. So, you know, we would see skunks in the area from time to time, but not really down in the part of the road that we live on. Usually they were 2 to 3 miles up the road. There's a ridgeline, and they seem to hang out there quite a bit. We didn't ever see skunks on our property, but then we would get this really strong skunk smell, and it would be when, because we work an odd shift, and we get home, you know, anywhere from 9 o'clock at night to 3 o'clock in the morning. And it would seem like we would get home, we would get out of our vehicle, and we would go up to the house. We would go back outside to feed the cats, and that's when we would smell the skunk smell. It wasn't when we first pulled in. It was actually later when we went back out to feed the outside animals. So that was a little odd, in my opinion. But, again, you know, I could logic that away. Then there was one morning we were leaving, probably 5 o'clock in the morning, and the skunk smell was overwhelming. And then there was this loud tree knock. And I'm calling it a tree knock because, you know, that's the thing that I think people will understand, you know, what it sounded like. Could it have been a branch breaking? We didn't really have a really severe winter this year, so it wasn't icy. We hadn't had a lot of heavy snow or anything of that nature, so it didn't seem like it was just a tree branch breaking. And it was a very distinct, pop of a knock. And we had heard that a few times before, but again, we were still not putting two and two together of could it be that we actually had, possibly a Sasquatch on the land. There were, the older people, there were legends in the hollow. It's very, very forested. It's very dense forest in the area we live in. So, there were legends, but there are legends everywhere about, wood boogers out there and things in the woods. And some of them are to keep the kids from running the woods at night. And some of them are people who really experience things. So we took it all with a grain of salt when we heard the legends. But then, we started having, more and more activity. And then it kind of quieted down for a while as far as any reference time that I could put to it. There were smells, there were knocks, there were noises, like something coming through the woods. We all always attribute that to, there's a deer, there's a rabbit, there's a bird rustling. All the things that, the normal human mind does to logic away something that most people, may not believe even exists. And then things got a little wilder in May.
Yeah, what happened in May?
Well, in May, we had been experiencing for probably a few months, honestly, probably about 6 months to a year, the dogs just barking like crazy. We have a kennel up on the hill, and the dogs would just start going absolutely nuts. And again, we were logicking away. It was deer, it was rabbits, it was something. And then we had a situation where one of the dog kennels, and these are the really good, nice chain link kennels, was literally shoved in. One side of the kennel was literally shoved in. So we had a lot of discussion. Oh my gosh, we've got a bear. But there had been no bear sign in the woods for over a year, year and a half. We did have a sow probably about a year and a half to 2 years ago. She was treed and actually shot by a local farmer because she was he had gotten the nuisance permit or whatever to take the bear out because, I guess she was threatening his animals or something. And so, he did euthanize that bear. And we had seen no more bear sign. We hadn't heard chattering. We hadn't heard grunts. We hadn't, nothing that gave us any indication there was a bear on our property. But the chain link kennel had been shoved in, like something very large had pushed it in.
Do you think, can I ask you real quick, Kelly, do you think it was actually trying to get to your dogs? Is that the impression when you're looking at the damage on the kennel?
In all honesty, I don't know, because the other experiences that we've had with this creature haven't seemed threatening. So,
I gotcha.
If the dogs were barking and it was feeling a little threatened, then it could have been, or it could have been, doing one of those, childish temper tantrums of, slamming into the fence and going, "You guys need to shut up," and telling the dogs to be quiet.
Yeah, it's interesting seeing the damage, though. But I didn't mean to cut you off. So,
No, it's okay. You ask a question anytime you want to. So again, and the other thing too that was interesting was it seemed like it was almost the same time every night that the dogs would kick in. It was usually 10:30 to 11:30 every night. So there was a consistency to the pattern, which we thought was unusual. Again, still logic it to, it must just be deer coming through the area, moving from one field to another to feed or whatever. Trying to take the skeptical approach and not just immediately jump to, "Ooh, we've got a wood booger." And, we're very logical and skeptical people. We have been paranormal investigators for years, and we do take a very scientific approach to, investigation, and even evidence that we receive there, we typically, throw out because, you know, if we're not convinced with what we're getting, we're not going to make something up and try to convince somebody else that, you know, we've gotten a picture of this or an EVP of that or whatever. So we do the same thing with, you know, whatever's going on the property.
And so what happens next? Is this where you actually saw the creature, or was there something else that happened prior to that?
Yeah, this is actually where, you know, it was the first part of May, and I was burning brush outside. There is a dusk to dawn light at our neighbor's house right across from us. And so, you know, I've got the brush pile. You know, I'm not afraid to be outside. I'm honestly not afraid of much of anything, except spiders. Spiders scare me. But so the dogs started barking, you know, and this was, you know, around 8:30 at night, and it wasn't usual or normal for the dogs to bark at that particular time, but they were barking, and then I heard something, and, you know, my brain immediately goes, oh, they scared a deer, and, you know, I'm going to see a deer. And then I see somebody come out from behind the neighbor's house, and it was like there was a bit of a pause, and then they came like toward the end of the house, you know, toward the front of the house, and there was a bit of a pause, and then literally just in maybe two steps, three steps across the yard, I saw them cross the road, and then I heard a huge splash into the creek. You know, I'm not a hunter, but, you know, I'm an outdoorsy kind of person, so I know what a bear looks like. And I know what, you know, other animals in the forest look like. You know, I've seen coyotes in the wild. I know a coyote wouldn't, you know, be walking across the yard. But, you know, I've seen cougars, different things of that nature. And we had also, I forgot to mention this, we had also been hearing, you know, some strange, you know, the knocking sounds. And then there were some strange grunts. There were, there was one night, and I'm sorry I'm backtracking, but there was one night there was an owl that was hooting. And then there was a repeating noise. You know how owls will hoot back and forth across a ridge or something at each other?
Yeah.
But the repeating noise sounded more like a human trying to mimic an owl instead of another owl. And that was an interesting thing, too, because it was almost, it had a guttural sound to it as well. So it was a lot deeper. So, you know, you have the owl going hoo, 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 and then this guttural sound going hoo, 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 you know, almost like a bass version of an owl, which that sounded really stupid. So you might want to cut that out.
No, very interesting. No, I think it's very interesting, you know. And they do that. I've heard that before in Texas, and I argued with the guys for the first 5 minutes, and I was like, it's an owl. You guys are delusional. It's an owl. And then it all of a sudden wasn't an owl. If that was an owl, that was a very big owl, bigger than me.
Yeah, 600-pound owl.
Yeah, that's what it sounded like. And going back to what you saw come out from behind the home, did it run like a man, and was there any details that you remember, or was it on all fours?
No, it was bipedal. And again, you know, it seemed like when it came from behind the house to the front of the house, it was almost, you know, sneaking and creeping. You know, the logic brain side of me immediately went, oh my gosh, we've got a prowler, you know, there's somebody coming through the woods, you know, they're around the house. And at the same time, I'm watching going, okay, is this one of those times when I need to go, you know, call the cops, get a gun, what do I do? And, you know, there's just a few seconds of trying to figure out, okay, what's my next move? And then it stepped into the light. And that was something I thought was a little unusual. I've always heard, you know, that they kind of shy away from light. But again, it took maybe two or three steps to get across this yard, down this little embankment across the road and into the creek. The whole sighting was probably 30 seconds, if that. And I might be over-exaggerating how long that it took, you know, the whole, you know, experience took. I don't know. You know, time, and I've actually heard this, you know, with folks talking, you know, to you and some of the other internet hosts, that it seems like time kind of stands still for that little bit, and it seems much longer than it is.
Yeah, that's true. That's true.
I would estimate at a maximum 30 seconds, because it literally was like sneak, 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 step, step, step into the creek. So it was kind of wild, but it was definitely upright. It moved like a very, very, very fast man. you know, it definitely didn't lumber like a bear. It didn't move like anything else. And it was too fast for a human. So, at that point, I'm going, oh, my gosh. And then, you know, everything started to kind of register, and I was like, that was a Sasquatch. And that was the moment when I was like, okay, I need a gun. Okay, if I get a gun, am I going to offend it? Is it going to feel threatened? If it comes back, you know, what's the right thing to do here? So, I'm racing all of those thoughts through my brain. But at the same time, I wasn't scared. It was more I was in shock of what I was seeing.
Yeah, and I don't blame you for being in shock and trying to come up with a game plan, you know, as far as what do we do here. That's fascinating. Did you tell your husband that you saw this thing, or did he see it?
He came out about that time, and I was like, you might want to get a gun. And he's like, why? And I said, just get a gun. So he goes back, and he grabs, you know, a hunting rifle, and he comes back out. And so then I explained to him, you know, what I had seen, and he immediately believed me. And he reminded me of a story he had told me years ago when we first met, that when he was a teenager, he ran those woods all the time. And he was out one time just exploring and caving and, you know, things like that. And he was standing in this area. I can't remember exactly what area he was standing in. And he literally was watching a hairy creature squatting on a rock overlooking a creek, right at the convergence of two deer trails. And he said, and it lasted maybe 30 seconds, and it never paid any attention to him. But he actually had a sighting as a teenager on that property.
That's interesting. That's very interesting. He kind of probably already had an idea of what was going on around that property. Did he ever describe to you what he saw? What did he say? It looked more like a man? Did it look more like an ape? Did he ever go into any details with you?
Basically, the way he described it to me was that, it was definitely not a bear. You know, he had seen bear in the wild before, and it definitely was not a bear. And it just looked like a very hairy man squatted down, like how you kind of squat down and you kind of put your elbows on your knees and, you know, like a catcher would sit in a baseball game.
Yeah.
That it was just there, and it was just watching, and it was looking, you know, up the deer trail and down the deer trail, and, you know, like it was waiting on, you know, a deer to come by. And then, you know, he was distracted by something. He looked away, and when he looked back, it was gone.
Yeah, that's fascinating. Has there been anything else that happened around that property beyond that sighting?
Well, it was probably about, a week later that, you know, my husband went out to actually get something out of our vehicle, and, you know, it's very dark on our side of the property. You know, the neighbors have a dusted on light, but it's very dark on our side. So, you know, he took his flashlight out, and, you know, he always kind of shines down through there first to make sure that there's not, you know, other critters that normally live on the land, you know, coyotes, or we also have some wild dogs that live out there, you know, so he always, you know, checks his surroundings. And so he shined the flashlight down, you know, toward the driveway, and there was something standing there. He said it was at least 7 to 8 feet tall, and he could see a silhouette and eye shine. And at that point, you know, he was like, you know, had a holy cow moment. And he said, you know, and then it was just gone. And he didn't hear any noise or anything like that. It was just there, and then it was gone. And he is not... He's not one of those people that lets his mind play tricks on him, even though, you know, he also understands that, yes, you know, the mind sometimes will see something and try to matrix it into what you expect to see. But, you know, he's not a jump to conclusion kind of guy. But, you know, with everything, you know, with the grunts and the weird little kind of owl hoots and the weird knocking that is unusual for the land, you know, it's been more than just, you know, When the weather gets cold and the trees kind of crack and bend, it's been much more than that. It seems very specific and very deliberate knocking is what we're hearing.
Yeah, I found that fascinating when you and I were talking the other day. You said that, like, when you guys pull up, there's one wood knock. You guys always hear it when you guys pull up to the home. And I find that fascinating.
It's almost as if, and again, I do believe that it's a Sasquatch, but it's like if he's close to the house, and he doesn't seem to have any fear of coming close to the house, but he just kind of gives a quick little, you know, hey, I'm here, wood knock. So that if we smell him, and I don't know if he's trying to, you know, posture or if he's trying to say, you know, hey guys, I'm in the neighborhood, just wanted to say hi. I don't know. I don't know how they think, you know, if it would be like any other animal, you know, if it was a bear 20 yards from my house, I would expect to hear it chomping. You know, if it felt threatened or if it wanted to let me know, hey, get out of my space. You know, so I don't know what the intention is, but we still don't feel threatened.
Yeah, you know, I don't think, I read through your encounters, and I don't think that, it doesn't appear to be aggressive. It almost looks more curious. And I know sometimes when people have these things on their property, they'll confuse curious with aggressive. And after reading everything that happened on your property, I really think it's just curious. Why do you think it showed up? I mean, why do you think that it's there now? Or do you think it's always been there? You guys are just noticing it now?
Well, I don't know if it's the same one that my husband saw when he was a teenager. You know, that was, oh God, you know, 25 years ago. Again, it's a very heavily forested area, and there's a very large patch of woods that covers, you know, probably 500 or 600 acres up the road from the house. And we've often wondered, you know, was this a juvenile that got kicked out of his clan? Because again, I think that that's another thing too, and I think that people make a huge mistake with Bigfoot. I think that the younger ones are much more curious and much less afraid of coming close and making themselves known. And the older ones, just like with any animal, you know, they have more experience, they're wiser. And I think the older males are possibly even more mature and more full of testosterone, which may make them more aggressive. You know, no different than if it was a female defending or protecting children. But I think the younger males are curious, and they're trying to see what their boundaries are, just like any teenager would do.
Yeah, and you really see that in, I mean, any animal kingdom, you know, beyond primates. Yeah. I guess we're primates too, but really in any species of animal, you'll see the younger ones seem to be a little more brazen. They seem to be a little bit more curious about things. Even little kids, you see little kids, you're like, don't talk to that stranger. What's wrong with you? And, mm-hmm. you know, but the kids are curious, and you could be onto something with that, but I didn't mean to cut you off.
Oh, no, that's okay. And it's just my theory on it. A couple other things I didn't mention. We have heard muffled conversation where it sounded like there were people like right behind the house, you know, actually talking to each other, you know, and of course, you know, we always check that out because, you know, if it's a poacher on the land, or even, you know, just the coon hunters or something that are crossing our property and didn't bother to say, hey, you know, we're crossing the property. Or, you know, somebody, you know, that is a little more dangerous and threatening to us, you know, trying to figure out how they can break in. We always check out, you know, things that seem more human. And so the muffled conversations have happened, you know, two or three times. But we've never found anything, you know, around the house. There's no footprints. There's no, you know, no sign that anybody's been walking around, you know, the immediate house area. I was trying to think. There was something else. Oh, the motion sensor lights. Up until probably after my husband had the experience with the eyeshine in the driveway, before that, every night the motion sensor lights were ticking on outside. I mean, pretty much every single night. And then after the eyeshine incident in the driveway, we haven't had the motion sensor lights kick on at all, and the dogs stopped barking.
Yeah, I wonder if they left. I wonder if they left the area.
I don't know. Maybe, you know, maybe the Sasquatch had a holy cow moment. You know, somebody saw me. I don't know.
Yeah, I hear you. What do you think that Sasquatch is, Kelly? What's your opinion?
Well, my opinion is that it is, you know, an animal. I know that, you know, in some of the DNA research, they have found, you know, some traces of human DNA. So it could be a long-lost ancestor or a long-lost cousin. I can't rule out that there's, you know, human DNA there versus other DNA that we haven't, you know, completely officially matched yet. I will use that term. You know, even like the mountain gorillas, you know, they stand up to 6 feet tall and can be up to 500 pounds. And so we already have examples of a great ape that, you know, comes close to at least the juvenile size of our Sasquatch. You know, they've also been reported to throw rocks at people they feel are threatening them. So there's so many similarities to the great apes and the silverbacks that we can't rule out that it has to be some sort of hominid, you know, ape species. There's just too many similarities to say that that's not what it is. I've read the reports and heard the stories where people think, you know, that it's, you know, like an alien species and that there's portals and dimensional portals and things. But anytime somebody says the word alien, I just go crawl under the bed anyway. It scares the crap out of me. So I don't want to think that they're aliens. I want to think that they're animals. And saying that, we have to treat them as such in the sense that, you know, I would never go out and hunt for an animal in that regard, like, you know, out of curiosity. If I did hunt, you know, and I wanted to go out and shoot a deer because I was going to consume the deer, that would be one thing. But I wouldn't go hunting a bear just to pick a fight with a bear. I'm not a scientist. I'm not a researcher in that regard. And I know that there are some really great researchers out there that really know what they're doing. But for the average person, I think that they're just asking for a world of trouble. But that's just my opinion, and you can throw that out too if you need to.
Yeah, no, I'm not going to throw it out. I appreciate your opinion. And, you know, I understand what you're saying. I mean, a lot of their behavior is very much like a known primate. They throw rocks. They bluff charge you. They, you know, if I said something throws rocks, it bluff charges you. It growls. It hoots and hollers. What do you think I'm talking about? Most people would say an ape. You know what I mean? Most people, right off the bat, you'd say that's an ape. But there, to me, I think there's more, a little bit more to them than that. But I understand why you're saying that. I mean, and I hope you're right, to be honest with you. I would sleep better knowing it's nothing more than just a wild animal, out there running around. You know what I mean?
Well, and you know, saying what my theory is on it, you know, does not diminish anybody else's theory. And there are people out there that are much more knowledgeable than I am and have much more experience than you know, my few interesting pieces of experience here, you know, and there may be a lot more to it's just an animal. You know, I think that anything that walks bipedally, you know, including us, we're all animals. But at the same time, there might be something more to it. You know,
it's hard to say. Hopefully one day we'll get the answers. You know what I mean? It's hard to say. That's why I love asking the question, because there's no wrong answer. You can't answer that question wrong, really. Some people may not like your answer, but it doesn't necessarily mean it's a wrong answer, because no one really knows, you know what I mean?
Well, I think that, you know, when we all put our opinions on the table, a lot of times it gives us an opportunity to come up with a working theory that can lead us to the answers. And so we have to accept everyone's opinion on it, whether we agree with it or not. Because that's how we find the truth of any situation. You know, it's kind of like when we were, you know, looking for the bonobos. You know, people believed they were there, and then we found them. And it took, you know, many different minds and many different people pushing their theories to be able to actually, you know, discover, you know, the species. And it's fascinating. You know, we're discovering new species every day, you know, in the Amazon and in Asia and probably even in the United States. I just haven't dug into the research on everything that goes on in the United States, you know, something more than just insects.
Yeah, there's definitely, you know, there's new species found every day, and you're right. It takes a lot of people to come together, and I think that this thing could be solved if a lot of people could come together, but that doesn't seem to happen. But keep me up to date. Let me know if anything else happens on that property, will you?
I definitely will, and, you know, if the footprint we were talking about earlier, some friends actually made a plaster cast, and if it turns out good, then I'll send you some pictures of that as well.
Yeah, please do. I'm really curious to see how that turns out. It was interesting, and for the audience, I will post a picture of the footprint below. It's actually a huge, huge footprint. But Kelly, I appreciate you coming on. Thank you so much for your time.
Well, thank you so much for talking to me. You've been absolutely a joy to talk to, and you do such good work, and I really appreciate the fact that you're there for people, because you know, my experience has been reasonably pleasant, and, you know, I'm not dealing with an aggressive Sasquatch, you know, to date, but I know a lot of people are very traumatized by their experiences, and having somebody who understands, who's been there, who understands, you know, their fear, their post-traumatic stress, I applaud you and what you do, and you keep up the good work that you're doing, because, you know, people like you are very much needed.
Thanks, love. Thanks for the kind words. And I hope everyone is enjoying their Memorial Day weekend. Thought I'd do a little bit longer show for everyone. Make up to the members for Bingo, even though I loved him. You guys will definitely hear more about Bingo. He'll definitely be on the show. Sorry, I can't help myself. But I thought, you know, I really hope everyone out there is enjoying their Memorial Day weekend. A lot of things coming up in the show. I got Jeff coming up next. He's from Oregon. He actually shot one of these things in the back 3 times, and the whole night turned into a nightmare. They surrounded his camp, and that's coming up here shortly. And we'll also hear from Timothy Renner from Strange Familiars, the Strange Familiars podcast. If you guys go to SasquatchChronicles.com, you'll see I post his shows. If you're listening to this on iTunes or on your Android, whatever podcast player, definitely check out Strange Familiars. Before we get into that, I want to talk about Duke Cannon. And Duke Cannon, thank you so much for sponsoring the show. I actually love your guys' stuff. I went and used my own promo code Sasquatch and bought a box of their campfire soap and some of the cologne and just more stuff. But if you get a chance, check it out. Duke Cannon's superior quality grooming needs for hardworking men are tested by soldiers. Duke Cannon partners with active duty military to develop new ideas and review products. Anything that doesn't meet the high standards of soldiers doesn't happen. Duke Cannon is committed to giving back to men and women serving our country. That's why a portion of their proceeds directly supports veteran causes. You definitely have to check out DukeCannon.com. They sell basically everything you need and nothing you don't. And I mentioned this on the last show. They have this big-ass brick of soap. It's modeled, it's rough cut, it's a brick style soap, and it's something that they kind of copied from what GIs used to use in the Korean War, and they say it smells like the Great Outdoors. I think it smells better than the Great Outdoors. If anything else, go buy yourself a bar of soap, the campfire, and get yourself some of that solid cologne, Oak Barrel Bourbon. God, it smells good. If you get a chance, check it out, DukeCannon.com. And right now, if you visit DukeCannon.com, you'll get 15% off your first order with the promo code Sasquatch. And it's free shipping on orders over $35. Definitely check them out. DukeCannon.com to get your 15% off. Don't forget to use the promo code Sasquatch. And I'll include the link in the description of the show. Definitely check them out. Thank you again to Duke Cannon for supporting the show. Let's get back to the show. I want to welcome Timothy Renner from the podcast Strange Familiars. Tim, thanks for coming on, man. Appreciate you being here on Memorial Day weekend.
Oh, you know, I love Sasquatch Chronicles, so it's always great for me to be here.
No, I love having you, man. I'm stoked that you're here. And I know you have an encounter, a historical encounter you want to share with us from Arkansas. I'll let you take it away.
Sure thing. Yeah, so this is from the Dallas Herald, Dallas, Texas, from April 5th, 1856. It's the Wild Man Again, a correspondent of the Caddo Gazette, writing under the date of the 28th Ultimo, which means the previous month, so it would have been the 28th of March, from Paraclifton, Arkansas, on Upper Red River, states that cold during the present winter has been, in that region, the severest within memory of man. The rivers were frozen solid, and the plains presented an unbroken sheet of snow. The writer relates the following story of an attempt to capture the most famous wild man who has been so often encountered on the borders of Arkansas and northern Louisiana. In my travels, I met a party from your country in pursuit of a wild man. They had struck his trail at a canebrake bordering on Brant Lake and the Sunflower Prairie. I learned from one of the party that the dogs had ran him to an arm of the lake which was frozen, but not sufficiently strong to bear his weight, which consequently gave way. He had, however, crossed, and the dogs were at fault. One of the party, mounted on a fleet horse, coming up, encouraged the dogs to pursue, but found it impossible to cross with his horse, and concluded to follow the lake around until he could ascertain the direction taken by this monster of the forest. On reaching the opposite side of the bend, he was surprised to see something in the lake, like a man, breaking the ice with its arms, and hastened, under the cover of undergrowth, to the spot where he expected him to come out. He concealed himself near the place, when he had full view of him, until he reached the shore, where he came out and shook himself. He represents himself as a stout, athletic man, about 6 feet 4 inches high. He was well muscled, and ran up the bank with the fleetness of a deer. He says he could have killed him with his gun, but the object of the party being to take him alive, and hearing the horns of his comrades and the howling of dogs on the opposite bank of the lake, he concluded to ride up and head him, so as to bring him at bay and then secure their prize. So soon, however, as the wild man saw the horse and rider, he rushed frantically towards them, and in an instant dragged the hunter to the ground and tore him in the most dreadful manner, scratching out one of his eyes, and injuring the other so much that his comrades despair of the recovery of his sight, and biting large pieces out of his shoulders and various parts of his body. The monster then tore off the saddle and bridle from the horse and destroyed them, and holding the horse by the mane, broke a short piece of sapling and mounted the animal, starting at full speed across the plains in the direction of the mountains, guiding the horse with his club. The person left with the wounded man informed me that the party was still in pursuit, having been joined by a band of friendly Indians, and thought that if they could find a place in the mountains not covered with snow, or a cane break in the vicinity to feed their horses, they might overtake him in a day or two.
That's crazy. From this whole report, it sounds like it got on the horse, really, took off with a stick in its hand, riding the horse.
These old reports, it's interesting because, these wild men, in some of these old reports, they do weird stuff, sometimes they're seen, they'll describe these 7-foot-tall guys covered in hair, and they'll say he's carrying a rusty musket. You go like, well, what's that about? Did it pick up a musket? Is it just using it as a club? What is it? What is this about? So every now and then you get these weird reports of, they'll do something like that. So, if we're to believe the report, it seems like it got on the horse, but, it's pretty wild. The attack is pretty horrifying too. It scratched out the guy's eye.
It is bizarre. What do you make of that report? What do you think set the creature off?
Being cornered probably. It seems like the guy kind of headed him off, and there were dogs behind him, and he was in front of him. And I don't think you want to corner something like this.
It's really bizarre. The whole story is bizarre, especially getting up on the horse with the stick in his hand. Reminds me of what's that movie? Gosh, I'm gonna go nuts now if I don't mention it. Where the gosh dang it, the monkey was in the laboratory. God, it's a recent movie too.
The Planet of the Apes.
The Planet of the Apes reminds me of Planet of the Apes when they're on the horses and they're riding through. It's bizarre, man. It's really bizarre.
Yeah, it's odd. I mean I think it's a creature because they talk about. I don't think a human's going to tear a saddle in half, or take bites out of a guy, in a fight. I think if it was a human, the fight would have gone a different way.
Yeah, and they would have said you would think they would have said it was a human. You know what I mean? As opposed to some wild man, the way they're describing it.
Right. Yeah. Some of these wild man reports, they're definitely people. Some of them you can tell it's like a mountain man or something. There's something that'll give it away. It's, they'll either talk to him or something. It's obvious that it's a person. But a lot of them like this, no person's doing that kind of attack, I don't think. Now, jumping on the horse, that's a bizarre detail. It's really bizarre. But, the rest of it certainly sounds like a Bigfoot attack.
Yeah, it does. And you would think guys in 1850, they're probably armed to the teeth. And so they're going to pull out their weapons, start shooting or whatever. But, it's a bizarre account, man. It's a really bizarre account.
Yeah. There's, and I got some more coming up. If we're going to do this, on the regular, there's some that definitely sound like, modern day creature reports, and others that are a little bit more bizarre.
Yeah. I hope we do more, Tim. I definitely enjoy the historical accounts. I love having you on. For the audience out there, check out Timothy Renner. The podcast is called Strange Familiars. You can pick it up on iTunes. Whatever your podcast player is, just look up Strange Familiars. And if you go to Amazon, you can definitely check out Tim's book. He's got Bigfoot in Pennsylvania, Bigfoot the Seventh Gate, Bigfoot West Coast Wildmen, which is one of my favorite books. Don't Look Behind You. He has a ton of books on there, and they're very well written.
And if any of your listeners come across any of these old newspaper reports, they can email them to me. And, maybe we can talk about them.
What's your email address, Tim?
StrangeFamiliarsPodcast@gmail.com.
Well, Tim, I appreciate you coming on, man.
Always a joy, Wes. Thank you.
Well, Well, as we continue on the Memorial Day weekend, I want to welcome Jeff to the show. Jeff, thanks for coming on.
No problem, Wes.
Yeah, I appreciate you being here, and I know your encounter took place in Oregon. If you would you just kind of start from the beginning, kind of tell us what you were doing and walk us into what happened?
Okay. Well, it was October. It was a day before opening season for general rifle for deer hunting in Oregon. And a friend of mine and I were up in the area of the Oregon Caves. We found this nice place. There's a road that went up above a clear cut, a big clear cut, and then we found right on the top of this ridge, there was like a bowl that was about 20 feet deep below the level of the road, and so we set our camp up in there, and we set it up in the afternoon, and I had a 50 by 50 camo net that went over the whole thing, and we had all our tables set up and stuff. And a little generator with a light string, and, you know, we had radio and stuff. And so we had our dinner, and we were sitting around the campfire, and there was this loud, you know, almost like an owl going, hoo, like that. And I was kind of laughing, and I said, I've never heard an owl do that before like that. And so I started hooing back. And it would hoo back and forth and back and forth, and it was right up above us. Sounded like, you know, just up on the top of the edge of the road level. This went on for about 20 minutes or so, and then we heard footsteps walk away. And my buddy he had been saying, that's not an owl. And I said, sure it is. And then when that happened, he said, how many owls do you know walk away on 2 feet? Well, I didn't really think too much of it. And so I had an international scout, and I was sleeping in the back of it. And I don't know what time it was, but I heard something walking on the road. You know, and it was a graveled road because a logging company had put the road in. And I heard something walking up there, and I just kind of yelled, hey, come back tomorrow. You know, I thought it was a deer. And now that I think about it, it was walking. It was 2 feet walking, not 4 feet. But anyway, we had our dogs with us, and these dogs were basically fearless. And the whole time we were there, they either wanted to be right around our feet or stay in the vehicles. And they were just, they didn't want to go out exploring or doing anything, and which was kind of strange. And so the next day, I don't go out walking around the woods the first day of hunting season because I've had too many people shoot at me. So anyway, we went driving around a little bit, looking around and stuff, and we came back in the afternoon, and about, I'd say it was about 100 yards or so from our camp on this road, it went up the side of a mountain on one side, and then the clear cut was on the other side and went down to the main road. And it was, I don't know, it had to have been at least a 5 or 6 acre area. And there was a big boulder. It was about 15 feet tall, and it's sitting right there on the edge of the road. So I decided I'd just climb up there and sit up there and see if I saw any deer out in that clear cut. Well, below me, about, I'd say around 40 feet, maybe 50 feet, I never got a chance to go back and check exactly these distances, and I never have been back there. But there was an old-growth log, you know, a coal log, laying there. And it was between 3 and 4 feet tall. And anyway, I was sitting up there for like 3 hours, and it was starting to get dusk. And it's like, well, I'm just about ready to pack it in. And I had an SKS rifle with the 5-round clip in it. And a bolt lock back, because those things, if you chamber around and then you want to unload it, it's real hassle. I hate those detachable magazines. Anyway, I always carried a 30-round mag in my cargo pocket on my thigh. Well, I'm sitting there in this foldable chair, and all of a sudden, this Bigfoot stands up. He had been, must have been crouching behind that log. He must have been crossing that clear cut, and when he saw me coming down the road or something, he crouched down behind that log. Now I figure, like everybody else, if you're down in a crouching position long enough, your joints and everything else are going to be screaming after hours. And anyway, he stood up. And I'd say, like I was telling you, I'd say he was between 7 and 8 feet tall. That log came just about right below his belly button line when he was standing up. So I couldn't see his what below about that level of him at that time. And he was jet black, short hair. He didn't have real long hair. I could see his ears. He had dark eyes, which it looked like the pupils were almost as big as his whole eye. And his eyes were kind of back in his head a bit, not like a person's right out on the edge, you know, right, just right there by your cheekbone.
Yeah.
And he had, you know, a big brow line, and then his forehead, from above his brow line, his forehead kind of swept back, you know, to kind of like a conical head. You know, it's kind of like pointy. I mean, not like an exact sharp point, but his forehead swept back. And I didn't really see any lips. He didn't have any neck. His whole face was skin, basically all the way around and then down along. He had hair under his chin like a beard, but his face itself was all skin. He didn't have like a beard or anything like that. And his nose looked like a boxer's had been punched too many times. It wasn't like a human nose, but it wasn't like a gorilla's nose either. And I've never seen a real gorilla. I've only seen them on you know, television or whatever. I have never seen one in person.
Yeah.
But his arms were down below his waist level when he was standing there, and he was looking at me like a deer that got caught in the headlights. And when he stood up and I saw this, my mind just, I was like, what is this? And I don't remember doing this, but while I was sitting there staring at him, I don't remember doing this. I detached a 5-round magazine and put the 30-round magazine into the rifle. And he looked towards our camp, and when he did, I could see a little bit of the whites of his eyes when he moved his eyes to his left. And that's when I grabbed the bolt and jacked around into the rifle. And he turned and took off running. And you have this fight or flight type thing when your adrenaline's going like that. Well, mine has always been the fight. And I started just firing at him basically from the hip. And I'm not like one of these people that's dangerous and just shoots at anything and like that. I'm not like that. But anyway, I just panicked. And I was firing, and the rounds were hitting behind him. He looked like he's running in slow motion, like when you see like a big elk or a moose and they're running, they look like they're running in slow motion, but they're not. They're really moving along. And he's taking really wide strides. I really couldn't tell you how wide they were because I never, you know, he ran along. I mean, they had to have been 7-foot strides anyway. He ran along for probably 100 feet or so, and then there was a little draw that went down and came back up. When he went down to that draw, I stopped. I took the rifle and put it to my shoulder, and when he came up the other side there, I zeroed him, and I fired. I thought I fired 4 rounds, and I think I hit him 3 times right across the back of his back, about probably 4 inches from the level of his shoulders, and I could see the puffs of dirt come off of his fur. So I hit him, and he fell down to one knee and got up and started running again, and the bolt was locked back, and I was out of ammo. And, I mean, this just, it happened so fast. Anyway, my buddy was calling on the radio going, "What are you shooting at? What are you shooting at?" Because we had little walkie-talkies. And I said, "I don't know, but it's coming straight towards you." And I climbed down off of the rock, and I can't run because I've been run over so many times by cars on motorcycles that my legs are all messed up, but I can hobble pretty fast. Anyway, I hobble back to the camp, And when on my way, he had a 44 Magnum lever action rifle, and this is the type of guy that never just wastes ammunition or anything. And he's shooting, blam, blam, blam. And I'm on the radio going, what are you shooting at? He said, well, I don't know, but it's right down here. There was some big old growth trees around that little bowl we were in that they had left. And anyway, when I got there, I just dropped my rifle, and I had a 9mm on my side. And I'm like, where is it? And he says, it's right down there behind that tree. And the tree was huge. You know, I'm 6'3", and if I put my arms around it, they wouldn't even come to the sides of it. And so I went down there, and I was trying to work my way around to see it. It kept moving, too, so I was kind of trying to shoot around the tree at it. And anyway, I kind of stopped that for a minute, and I was telling him, don't shoot, because I don't want to get shot in the back. And it took off, and it went up, and it took off up over the top of the crest from where we were, and then I don't know where it went from there. And so I had a bunch of cases of guns. I'm a gun collector and stuff. And I started opening these cases and stuff, and we fired up the generator, and this started by them throwing some big rocks, and they were landing on the road and rolling down. And when I say big, I mean like twice the size of a bowling ball, and some smaller rocks, but it didn't seem like they were very accurate with that. I've heard other people say they're real accurate throwing rocks, and they're throwing big sticks and stuff. There was, I don't know how many of them there was. I estimate there was at least four of them.
And Jeff, can I ask you real quick? So this is now nighttime. He took off, and how much time passed before they returned?
That's what I was going to say. I got the generator fired up. I got out the gun cases probably about between 20 minutes and half an hour. And then they started throwing stuff. And so I had you could hear them up there in this wooded hill, above us. But luckily, when they built this road, they had put a huge ditch along it that went down and down about where that boulder was. It went under the road with two of those like 6-foot culvert pipes. So it was big drainage through there. And it was probably close to it had to have been 10 feet deep and 15 feet wide, something like that. You know, it was a big, and it had big rock in it and everything. And so they started out by throwing stuff at us. But whenever I was telling my buddy, I had a spotlight plugged into my truck, and it was like one of those million candle power spotlights. And I said, when you hear something, you shine that light where you hear it. And then I'd fire like a 3-round, 4-round burst. And so we were doing that, and that kept them kind of on their toes. And I think that's one of the reasons that they never, I mean, if they would have all came at once, they probably would have bum-rushed us and killed us, but they were they started rolling big rocks down, but luckily they would go in and land in that ditch. But their idea was they were trying to roll those rocks down into our camp. And there was some old coal logs up there, too, and I have no idea how long they'd been up there, but some of these were like 3 feet in diameter and like 8 feet long, 10 feet long. They were rolling that stuff down, too, but it kept falling in the ditch. And so this would go on for like 15 minutes and then stop, and I guess they'd regroup. And they never made any screaming noises or any noises, and I never smelled any horrible smells or anything. But, you know, it'd be like 15 minutes and they'd start at it again, or it'd be 20 minutes or half an hour. And this went on all night long. Like I told you, I capped off like 800 rounds with various guns that night. And in the morning, as soon as it started getting light, we even left the camo net there. We just threw everything in our trucks and left. That chair and my 5-round hunting clip were left on that rock. Anyway, as soon as it got light, we left. I mean, I have never been so scared before in my life. And I mean, I've been shot, stabbed, all kinds of stuff. but I have never been as afraid for my life as that night.
Yeah, and it's amazing that it went on all night. So you just basically fired off every round you had from just about every gun you had, it sounds like.
Yeah, I had an AR-15 with a 90-round snail drum in it and like 10 30-round clips. I had an AK-47 with 275-round drums and at least 10 30-round clips. I had pump shotguns, automatic shotgun, single-shot shotgun, and I don't know, at least five various handguns. And I think when we got back, I think I had like five rounds left in the AR-15, and that was about it, except for some shotgun shells. But I'm not sure how many rounds I fired that night. Over 159 millimeter, I know that. Anyway, but it was just every time we heard them move, he'd shine the spotlight, even if he wasn't, you know, we couldn't see them. We seen their eye. You could once in a while you'd see their eyes reflect. And by the way, their eyes were reflecting green.
That's interesting.
I never saw red. They were reflecting green, like kind of like one of my dogs does. I had that happen before. We were at another place, and we kept seeing these green eyes reflecting, and they were up about 8 feet off the ground. And then every time you shine a light there, you didn't see anything. And then a few minutes later, you'd see the reflection of these eyes. Anyway, but they were green also. That's another complete different thing. But, yeah, it was very terrifying.
Yeah, it is. You know, and they do have a vengeance streak. You and I were talking about Ape Canyon and kind of a similar situation where one of the guys shot one. And then that night, they all kind of came in, and it was an attack on the cabin. Do you think if they could have got a hold of you, they would have killed you?
Oh, absolutely. Like I said, I think the only thing that kept them at bay is every time they were trying to make a move or they started crashing down, because they weren't trying to be quiet. You know, he hit that area with a light, and, you know, I'd fire a burst at him. And I think that's the only thing that kept them. But, you know, okay, people say, oh, they might be human or something. They're an animal. If they were human, they would have been smart enough to figure out, go way out, come back around and flank us or something. You know, looking at that one when we were staring at each other, to me, there was no humanity in that thing at all. That thing was an animal. It was some kind of a... what do you call it, a bipedal, or a, I don't know. It had simian-like features, but I could see where somebody would say, oh, that thing was part human. But to me, no, it was an animal. It didn't have that real spark of intelligence to me. It was an animal.
And yeah, I understand what you mean.
A very large, dangerous. This one was not big, giant. His shoulders were about 4 feet across, but I think he was a young one. He wasn't all huge and muscular like they say, like a weightlifter or something. I mean, he had big arms. I mean, his arms must have been. At one time when I used to weightlift, I had like 22 or 19-inch biceps, and his had to have been almost twice that size, but. He didn't look all. You could see I could see the muscles and stuff moving, you know, under his fur, especially when he turned around, and took off running. But he wasn't like the Patty, the Patterson film. He wasn't big and huge like that or anything. He was like slim and trim, like a runner. But like I said, I don't think he was. I don't think he was full grown either.
Yes.
I would estimate that he was between 7.5 and 8 feet tall, right in there.
Still pretty huge, man. Still pretty huge. You know, and I always say, put a gun in a man's hand who's terrified, and you're going to get shot. Do you think it was just fear that kicked in? Do you think that's why you started shooting?
Pardon me?
Do you think it was fear that kicked in? Do you think that's why
Absolutely.
You started?
Absolutely. It was almost a panic. And when I knew looking at it, it was not. Human. Yes, it was absolute terror. I mean,
yeah,
I've
never
seen anything like that in my life.
Yeah, I don't blame you for shooting. I probably would have shot too. And you know, that is fear when you don't realize you unclipped a 5-round mag and plugged in a 30-round mag and you're doing
it. I have no recollection of doing that.
Yeah, that's definitely fear kicking in. Have you ever been back, or has there been anything else strange that happened around?
I took my brother up there a couple of years. I didn't even go. I wouldn't go in the woods for like 2 years after this. I wouldn't go camping or anything. I'd still go riding on my ATCs and stuff like that. But I never went camping or anywhere, and I didn't go up in that area for like 2 years. And my brother that lived in Texas at the time, he's passed now, but he believed me, and he wanted to see one. And so he flew out here, and we packed up all the gear in the scout there, and we went up to we went up there, and that road had been mud slid out. The whole side of the mountain had slid out and across the main road there. So we ended up camping past that mudslide. And so we set up camp and everything, and it was starting to get dark. And so I just started making that hooing noise. And after about 15 minutes, I was getting an answer, and it was way across the valley. It was real faint at first. And I wait a little while, 5 minutes, and do it again. And then after a minute or so, I'd get an answer back of the same, you know, whoo, like that. But each time, it was getting closer and closer. And when it got into where it was probably 200 yards away or so, my brother started panicking. And he's like, no, stop that, stop. And I said, well, this is what you came all the way here for, so... You know, I am not going to raise a gun to this thing. I said, here's a table full of guns. Take your pick. If you shoot it, be ready to possibly be killed because it all hell's going to break loose. Anyway, where we were camped, there was a dead end, and on one side it kind of went up about 15 feet above us. And the thing, I just said, I'm going to bed. And I went into my tent and zipped up my tent. And because I didn't want to see it again. And he was freaking out and shining a spotlight around and everything. But it came up and it walked right along the top of that ridge and right there. And it kind of hung out there and I guess looked at him for a little while and then it left. And the next day, he took all kinds of pictures of the footprints. It was during the dry season, though. And you could see the footprints and stuff, and he'd have like a cigarette pack next to it for reference of the size and stuff. And he took a bunch of pictures of footprints. But anyway, that made a believer out of him. And after he passed, I tried to get his photographs from his wife, and I think she threw him all his stuff away like that instead of sending it to me. But,
Yeah, I mean, it's a terrifying account, and again, I don't blame you for really shooting. So your opinion of these things is it's an animal. There was really nothing more. It's fascinating how you talk about the eyes, kind of like lemur's eyes. Is that kind of how you would describe them?
I don't know. Well, they didn't bulge out or anything like that. It's just that they it seemed to me like when it was looking straight at you, you couldn't see any white around the edges of its eyes. Like the pupils were really big, but then, you know, these things are mainly nocturnal, so I could see them, their eyes having developed like that. But when it turned to look to the side, then I could see whites when its eyes turned. You know what I mean?
Oh, I gotcha. I gotcha.
Then I could see white.
But in your opinion, you would say that it's a wild animal?
Absolutely, and can be a very dangerous one, too. They were rolling logs, those logs down, that must have weighed over a ton. And they were getting them moving and rolling down the hill. And rocks, you know, that were like close to 3 feet in circumference, you know, I don't know if they were picking them up and tossing them, but they got them going down the hill and stuff. And they were throwing like rocks twice the size of a bowling ball that were hitting the road and bouncing and rolling down into our camp and throwing sticks that were probably 5 or 6 inches around and 3 or 4 feet long, but those were hitting the camo net and stuff. But
yeah, thank God you were armed to the teeth. I think that really held them at bay, made them think twice about coming in too close. You know what I mean?
Well, yeah, because like I said, we're on. You know, as soon as you hear something, you know, spotlight and fire, or just fire. Anyway, yeah, I doubt any of that would have happened if I hadn't have shot that one.
Yeah, no doubt that.
I felt really bad. I felt really guilty about it. You know what? I've gone deer hunting with my buddies, but I just run the camp and do the cooking and stuff. I no longer have any interest in shooting wild animals. I have never shot anything except clay pigeons since then.
Yeah, and again, I don't blame you for shooting it. I mean, you know, like I said, put a gun in a man's hands who's terrified. Someone's going to get shot. And, you know, I mean, I totally understand why you would shoot. It is fascinating, though, that you hit it three times in the back. It dropped to its knee, got back up, and kept going. And that's kind of a warning, you know, to everyone else out there wanting to pull the trigger.
Right. Well, here's the thing. And that was probably at about, okay, let's see. I never have been up back there to know. It was less than 100 yards when I shot him like that. Now, a 7.62x39 round is 123 grain hollow point going about 2,300 feet per second. The ballistics are almost the same as a 30-30. The 30-30 is usually like 158 grain, but they're going a little slower than that. But the ballistics are almost identical. So anybody who's shot something with a 30-30, they're a really underestimated cartridge. It has the basic same ballistics as that, and that's nothing to sneeze about because a 30-30 round will go through a quarter-inch plate of steel.
Yeah, anyway, no, it's a big round, yeah.
You know, it was like a runner that tripped and fell down onto one knee and then got in one hand, right hand, he fell down on his right knee and his right hand hit the ground and he got up and started running again.
Can I ask you, why do you think that, do you think it's just the size and the girth of hitting it? You know, 30-30 is a big, pretty big round to hit someone with. I mean, it'll take just about anything down, really. What was your impression? Do you think it was just his size and it didn't affect him as much? Or why do you think he was able to get back up and keep going?
Because I didn't hit anything vital. If I'd have hit him in the spinal cord, I think he would have been done. But I didn't hit him dead center. There was like two to his right-hand side and one to the left-hand side of his spine. And as far as I can tell, I mean, it happened really fast. But I didn't hit anything vital. And these were Russian-made hollow points. I've shot a deer with a 30-30 at less than 50 feet, and a 100-and-something pound deer did a complete 360 in the air before it hit the ground. But that's, you know, the deer aren't real big around here. But, the size of the animal and that I didn't hit anything, you know, I didn't hit anything, you know, crucial for it, you know, to kill it, like a heart shot or a spine, neck, like that.
I gotcha. It is interesting, though, how they go back. Even though, you know, I kind of tend to agree with you, I think they're more animalistic, but it does seem odd they would go back and get buddies and come back to teach you a lesson that night. That almost feels more like human-like behavior, wouldn't you say?
Well, yeah, but I think that the other ones were there the whole time anyway.
Oh, I got you. You don't think he actually went back? You think they were around you guys while you were there at the camp?
Yeah, I think they were watching us the whole time. And I have no idea why that one was... Did he boffin down through that clear cut knowing, well, obviously he didn't know I was there. Or, you know, I mean, I don't know why he was going through that clear cut when we had our camp right there and we were there. It seems kind of dumb to me because it was clear cut, then it just had the little reprod trees, you know, when they replant them.
Yeah.
And I figured that'd be a good place because the deer like to eat those little new sprout growths off of those. And so I have no idea why or, you know, what he was doing in the place he was. And then, like I said, when I came walking down the road, he must have ducked down behind that big old coal log. And so, yeah, I have been back up there, and it was mud slid out. And then, let's see, those 2 years ago, that same friend of mine and I went up, and we camped like 2 miles away from there. Back towards civilization along a creek there, and I had a quad, and he didn't have any ATV or anything. I said, I'm going to go for a little ride and go take a little peek see up there. And I have I had with me a custom-made AK-47 pistol that I had with me and my 44 mag. And it looks like they had redone that road, but it hadn't been used in so many years. It was overgrown up like 6 feet, and then these bushes were almost making like a canopy just about. But there was like where somebody had been riding quads or side-by-sides up through there, and the grass between the tracks was about 3 feet high, and then I started getting into this like tunnel. And I went in there a little ways, and every sense I had just went on full red alert. The hair on the back of my neck was standing on end, and I just stopped, and I just put that thing in reverse and back down and left. And that's the last time I've been there. And I would like to go up there and see if that road does go all the way up, but I want to go with several people, you know, packing some heavy artillery.
Yeah, I don't blame you. I don't blame you.
But I would like to go up there and look at that area again if we can get up there. It looked like they had fixed the road since then. They probably fixed it during the time of the biscuit fire because they fixed a whole bunch of roads out this way during the biscuit fire and after the biscuit fire in case, you know, so they could get back up into these places. But it looks like it had been fixed and then just overgrown from not being used.
Yeah, I hear you. And you have to let me know if you go back, if anything happens. And I would definitely be careful going back. But, you know, it's a cautionary tale, too. You know, I know a lot of, I always tell people don't shoot these things on your property. Off your property is a different story. But it's still a cautionary tale because it didn't quite go down and, you know, your life was in danger the night before. And you hear a lot of historical accounts like that, you know, where guys don't leave or they start shooting. And these things have a revenge streak to them where they will come in, you know what I mean?
Well, they say that, like, apes and chimpanzees and stuff can remember somebody doing them wrong and hold a grudge against them.
Yeah, you're right. You're absolutely right. I've watched things on chimpanzees where a guy was tricking them and chimpanzee didn't care too much for that guy. And you can tell it held a grudge against that one guy. And it was only that one zookeeper it held a grudge against. So you're right, I mean.
Yeah, I forgot to tell you this. Okay, when that happened, I got home the next day. I called the BFRO, and I got their number. I called them, and I was telling, I don't know who I was talking to, but I was telling them what happened, and about they started rolling the rocks and everything down. And he said, nah, I don't believe you. I think you're lying. I think you're making this up because there's never been any accounts of Sasquatches being aggressive towards humans. And I'm like, say what?
Yeah, it doesn't shock me. Doesn't shock me one bit. It's a researcher for you.
You know what? Whatever. And, you know, and everybody I try to tell about it, you know, they make fun of you and, you know, make jokes and, yeah, and, you know, it's just like it's nice to talk to somebody who actually believes me.
No, you know, I appreciate it. Yeah, I appreciate you coming on the show. I think it's a fascinating account. And, you know, I mean, that's how you get, sometimes Bigfoot researchers, that's the way they act. But I find it fascinating. I think it's a very cautionary tale. Like I said before, it's you know, think twice before you if you can in the moment. You know, maybe not shoot unless you absolutely have to. But in the same breath, I mean, I think most people could understand being so terrified. You just start shooting. And
yeah, I panicked. I mean,
yeah, I don't blame you.
It's just like, and you see something, you know, that back then my eyesight was a lot better too. You know, and the thing's only 50 feet away or right in there. I mean, you know, when you go through your whole life I've seen just about every animal in the United States. I've been all over the United States. I've been to Europe and stuff like that. But when you see that, it just, you know, it just, it's sensory overload.
Absolutely. Yeah, you're absolutely right. You know, that's what I was telling you the other day about all the people that have jokes. It's all fun and games until you run into one. Then all of a sudden it's not so funny anymore.
That, and once you see one like that, it changes your whole life. I mean, the way you look at things. And, you know, and the thing was, I wouldn't go camping or anything for a couple years. And I finally decided, you know what, I'm not going to let this one incident ruin my lifestyle. But, you know, I was pretty goosey there the first few times going back out camping again and stuff. But, you know, I've gotten over it since then.
But, yeah, time helps.
Yeah, and, you know, the thing is I really regret doing what I did. Now I feel like, you know, it wasn't right, but it happened, you know. If I see one again, that's not going to happen unless it's a life or death situation. And I'll tell you, I mean, to anybody out there that thinks they're going to go out there and just shoot one, I don't know how fast that thing was running, but I've seen a bear, a big cinnamon bear, about 400 pounds, running downhill. And I estimate that thing was probably doing close to 30 miles an hour. And this thing went every bit as fast as that. I mean, they can run, they can cover ground faster than you can, than your mind can fathom at the time. You know, they're, the thing will kill you in a heartbeat, especially if it gets a hold of you. I mean, they've just got fantastic strength.
Yeah, no, I would agree with you. And, you know, I don't think anyone can fault you for shooting. It's a fascinating account. I'm so glad that you came on and shared it, you know, and took the time to share it. So thank you, Jeff, for coming on the show. I really, really appreciate being here.
Okay, well, I'll get in contact with you if we're going to be going up there or if you want to come out and
yeah, absolutely.
Show you some places around.
Yeah, absolutely, man.
Okay. I've got your number.
All right, brother. You take care of yourself.
Okay, you too. Thank you very much for having me on your show.
Oh, you're very welcome.
Okay, bye-bye.
And that's it for tonight, everyone. Remember, if you've had an encounter, shoot me an email. My email address is wes@sasquatchchronicles.com. If you get a chance, check out sasquatchchronicles.com. You can become a member and get additional shows. Until next time, everyone. Someone is a human inviter.